Vietnam.
Patrick Dan, big in Vietnam. I'm a hot retard.
Lakitasar, Lakitasar.
No chance. No chance. No chance. No chance.
Shiny, shiny, the down behind me. Shiny, 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 na na. Shiny, shiny, the down behind me. Shiny, shiny. Shiny, shiny.
How you going, guys?
Hello there.
Oh, very shiny up here.
Oh, I love that tune.
Oh, isn't it? It's strangely sexy.
Oh, it's fucking very sexy.
For some reason.
Very sexy.
And she looks very sexy in the leotard.
Incredible.
The little sort of undie thing.
Yeah, the undie thing was like a chastity belt, I think, or something.
Yeah.
Like a leather thing. But I love the song, and today I'm Sammy Harlan, by the way.
And I'm Jay Jovi.
And you're listening to the 80s montage. We're here for another week. Now, we've had a lot of mail about the last episode, what the fuck does that song mean?
Yeah.
So we're doing another one tonight.
Number two,
because we've had a bit of a demand for the idea and people loving it because we don't really know what they meant, but they were great, you know?
And I think, like, we went into this concept because we thought, like, the songs were going to be shit. They're actually fucking great. Like, a lot of the songs are, like, really, really catchy. But upon reflection, it's like, yeah, I never did know what that actually meant. Like this one.
Okay, so this was one of your ones, Shiny Shiny. Now let's just talk about the eclipse. Everyone, how are you all going with the bloody eclipse?
Has it affected anybody?
It has me. But I'm really happy about it.
Yeah?
I just think it's shifting out all the fucking dead weight.
I really think it's a, you know, I know nothing about astrology.
Yeah.
But I feel an eclipse is like the ending of something and the starting of something else.
Yep.
So if that's happening for you, right at the moment, you're just in sync with the universe, I guess.
Well,
is that where you're at?
Yeah. So mine happened in the seventh house of relationships.
Oh, yes.
So it could be about work partners. It could be about the relationship you're in or just colleagues or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
That definitely changed for me.
Yeah.
But I'm actually quite happy about it because I think it was getting close to expiry date anyway.
Mm.
Now, I know that your partner's been going through some stuff. Now, the eclipse is in Aries and we've also got Mercury retrograde in Aries.
Oh.
So it's cutting really quickly.
Because Mika is in Aries.
That's right. So he'd be going through it a lot more than the average bear.
Yeah.
Because if you're in Aries and there's Chiron in Aries as well, so there's a lot of drama happening. So even if you find yourself amongst the drama guys and you find yourself losing friends and stuff, you've just got to let them go.
Yeah.
Because it's just the universe doing shit for you. It's like bookkeeping, you know.
Yeah.
Bookkeeping of idiots.
If only we could, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
If only as human beings we could let go, you know what I mean, without all the anguish.
Do you know, because I do look at astrology a bit, I understood something was going to happen and it wasn't surprising for me. I was like, that doesn't surprise me. There's a lot of projection going on, a lot of people thinking that they're in the right and they're in the wrong and then they're playing games and it's very airy, like Aryan and very angry.
Yeah.
And I was thinking about it today. I was thinking, like, do I always cause this kind of anger? Maybe I do when I leave a band. Maybe I do. But on the other side of the coin, you actually get to know who your real friends are when you tell them about this experience.
Yeah.
And they go, what the fuck?
Mm.
And you know what I mean? And I pretty much felt like Rewind 80s was where I was meant to be more than anything.
Yeah.
Because even though it's a cover band, it's who you're in a band with that's more important. It could be fucking Madonna, right? And if you don't get along, you don't want to be there.
You know what? It's just – and the universe constantly tries to teach us the lesson. It's about people. Everything is about people. Everything is about the relationships between people. And that is the most important thing. It doesn't matter, like, what industry it is, like, what you're doing, what the activity is, what the occupation is. It's always, always, always about the connection between two people.
That's right. And I'm seeing a lot of the themes about validation.
Mm.
The validation theme's coming up for the weaker people.
Yeah.
I need to be validated. I'm a Virgo. I don't want to validate.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Mm. I've done it. I've seen it. I've been there. I'm not I don't need validation.
Yeah.
You don't need validation. Mm. So it's hard on those people because what they're doing is blaming the people that don't need validation as a part of their problem. But if you get rid of us, the problem's still there, mate.
Yeah, yeah, exactly right.
You know, and I'm talking in circles, but I'm trying to sort of, you know, write in if this is making sense to any of you, because I know now relationships and jobs and stuff like that has all changed for a lot of people. There's been a few deaths around as well, and that's another thing with Eclipse. They bring deaths, and my little nephew's grandmother died, and it was horrible.
Awful.
And that kind of stuff will happen. Mm. So if something happens with a friend that you're not too sure about, just think it could have been worse. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
People I think some people in today's world are very disposable.
Yeah.
Like fucking cameras in the 80s. I just think no one's stable anymore.
So sometimes I think we give people more worth than they're actually going to have on us. You know what I mean?
100%.
And then when they let us down, we're all surprised because we sort of put all these expectations on them like they were going to sort of provide us with so much more.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And in actual fact, they were just meant to sort of teach us a little lesson and send us on our way.
That's it, because the eclipse 6 months before and 6 months after, you can feel the changes.
Yeah.
So mine sort of started 3 months ago and then it sort of changed and then it was like bang. And I knew in my body, you're not meant to be here.
You do know.
Yeah.
You do know.
And you just can't fight it because there's nothing you can do to make that situation better.
See, when you're younger, you do have a lot more energy and you're like, oh, yeah, I'm going to work against the, you know, I'm going to sort of do my hardest to sort of keep it going and all of that shit. When you're sort of like, you know, established.
Yeah, that's right.
You've got no time for it.
No.
And you know that all those efforts are futile. You could be putting all of that energy into something creative.
That's it. And the ending of my friendship had a lot of passive aggression in it and it was just 15-year-old shit, man.
Yeah.
Like I run a band. That's what I do. I run a band. I run a tour. We've just come back from Tasmania for 2 days.
Yeah.
Thank you to everyone that came to our Tassie gigs. Mm. I hope you had a great time. It's what I do. Yeah. So if I give you some advice, maybe fucking listen and not get rid of the fucking mole,
but
you know.
The thing with advice is you can take it or you can leave it.
Exactly.
You can take it or you can leave it. You can, you know, it's as simple as that. People aren't having a go at you trying to drag you down just because they sort of, you know, might want to impart some wisdom onto you. You know what I mean?
Well, this was about validation. I'd stopped validating because I was tired.
Yeah.
And I could see the bigger picture.
Yeah.
I could see it
really
clearly. And then for me, that's not good to have in my life because I don't need validation.
Yeah.
I don't fucking need it.
You get sick of feeding other people's egos.
You know what I mean? No one in Rewind 80s needs to be validated. Mm. Do I need to suck every player's dick on the fucking stage and go, you're amazing? Never.
You don't need to.
I don't need to, but it would help, wouldn't it?
Be nice.
That's right. So, no, maybe in the early days, but, I mean, I just it's been a really tricky time. So what you've got to do, guys, is eat really well, because some of you might have some the eclipse in your sixth house, which is all about your health and stuff. Just eat really well, drink heaps of water. Some people fast on the eclipse, you know.
Oh, is that right?
Some people don't eat at all because the food can be quite toxic.
Can you still eat ass?
You can eat ass, but I don't know how good it is.
Some better than others. What was I going to say? Something about, you know what I find generally in life? Not to react. Try not to react.
Yeah.
Try to sleep on things.
Yeah.
Your subconscious. Yeah. Your subconscious.
Yeah.
Gives you sort of solutions.
Yeah.
You wake up and things are so much more clear. You play out that stuff in your dreams. You know what I mean?
I do like to react pretty straight away.
Yeah.
I like to nip it in the bud. But it depends on the person. If I know that person can't take that, I will pull back.
Yeah, yeah.
Because I will fucking scream the fucking country down.
Yeah.
Right? But if I know they're not strong enough, I won't do it because it's not my karma. You do it.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
You know, it's okay that you think I'm a bad person. That's fine. I know what I am.
Yeah.
Right? My whole family knows what I am.
Yeah.
I have a family around me.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah.
There's a fucking difference.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, you just got to be really careful with people with all the other stuff. You may be just the target of what they're going through.
You know what? Like I used to sort of yell and scream and get a lot of enjoyment out of that. These days I just shut the door on that person.
Yeah.
And you know I'm like that, you know? Like you once said you're a cutoff guy and I am.
I am too. Like,
I have to cut that off.
That's good.
You know what
it's
I mean?
It's good to be like that.
Sort of in this situation I'm in at the moment, the other person was like, I want to call them and like blast the shit out of them.
Yeah.
And I said, don't react.
Yeah.
Shut the door on it. Never speak them.
Yeah.
Another word.
See, I would speak to them again, but they've cut me off, you know what I mean? So it's like their reasoning is their reasoning. But the eclipse is really tricky. You might find yourself losing your job even, guys, and you might have to – but something else will come along.
Yeah, it's not the being all
It's a reset.
Yeah, it is.
It's
really
a reset of what's happening in life. But we must get on with the show.
We should, but if something weird's going on at the moment
There's a lot of weird energy.
It's a reset, guys.
There's a lot of weird energy.
Maddie's just showing us an awful image to do with the eclipse.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't know.
Took that. But, yeah, look, it's a tough time at the moment, guys. If you need, just really look after your body. Just really chill the fuck out. Yeah. Don't worry. Nothing is ever as big as it seems.
No.
You know.
No, that's it.
But yeah, so
Hazy Fantasy. Will I read some lyrics?
Shiny.
I ain't lying because there ain't no time. No city, it's a pity because I dress divine. City smokes, people choke. Big meanie, he's a genie. And we ain't got a hope. No chance, no chance. No clues there. Well, I feel fine. No, it ain't no crime. I was dreaming of a demon and I ate a dime. The dime floats, the colonel boasts. Send them up the hill, boys. This ain't a joke.
Yeah, no logic there.
No, nothing there.
Must have been an eclipse when they wrote this.
I think they might have been enjoying some treats.
That's a good thing. That's right. The treats can help.
Many a great song was written on treats.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah?
Treats can fuck with your brain, though, people.
Yeah, they can.
Yeah.
Yeah.
As much as you think they're not, they fucking are.
Yes.
Now, I don't know what shiny, shiny means, to be honest with you. All I know is she was gorgeous. He was like the junkyard dog hanging out.
Apparently it's an anti-nuclear war song.
Oh, yeah, that's right, because there's visuals in the background.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
The paper cutouts and stuff.
I don't get that from anything in the lyrics, though, the lyrical content. I don't know.
Right. Well, there you go. Yeah. That's an interesting one. Should we go on to the next one?
Should
we go on to the next? We've got music trivia tonight too with a very good friend of ours.
We do later on.
Very good. Lily's on the line.
Oh.
All right, here we go. This is one of yours as well, babe. We'll be right back. I love them.
I love them too. Oh. And this sort of, I don't know, to me this is not Susie and the Banshees. Like this isn't sort of this is like I touch myself for the Divinyls, you know what I mean?
Right.
This is their big like poppy hit kind of thing.
Right.
Because this was the only one that charted in the US for Susie and the Banshees.
Right, okay, I didn't know that.
But this came out in 1988, this which 1988 isn't a very Susie and the Banshees year, you know what I mean? To me they sort of belong to the full earlier. Sort of crossover from post-punk yeah. into new wave, you know?
What was the one you did in night version? Was it Kiss Me?
Yeah.
What's it called?
Kiss Them For Me. Or
Kiss Them For Me. Yeah. I thought that was a bigger track than
oh,
this
yeah,
one.
Oh, yeah, God, yeah. That's like sort of yeah. know, typical Susie and the Banshees.
I love them. I couldn't tell you what it was about though.
Mm.
But you know what? That's what she was about. No one knew exactly what was going on.
They didn't know what to expect.
I met them at a record store in Melbourne. What was the
serious?
One in Bourke Street? Gaslight.
What's that?
They came to Gaslight, yeah. her and Budgie.
Right.
And because they would, I don't know if they still date. I'm sure they do, but I'm not sure. Her and Budgie came to Gaslight and she's very, very powerful woman and yeah. he's just as powerful.
She's quite
a real power
tall.
Couple. Oh, I think, well, Budgie's huge.
Yeah.
Budgie's fucking tall.
Yeah.
So I couldn't really tell.
Yeah.
But the thing about Susie is she's striking looking and that goth thing was sort of her thing really.
Yeah.
And – but I think she was a real sweetheart as well.
And out of all the goth bands, I really feel they were the most powerful of that time.
Yeah, because they were undercurrent as well as commercial.
Yeah.
And this is the thing. If you can be undercurrent and commercial, that's a
skill. That's the hugest gift.
It's the hugest thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. You can do.
Yeah. It's like sort of Depeche Mode, I guess, like being able to be commercial but also like completely underground.
Yeah, yeah, that's
because
right.
Because the underground will give you longevity.
What was the Japanese song they had? Japanese Garden or something or?
Susie and the Banshees?
Yeah, or was
yeah,
it?
Yeah, Japanese Garden or something. Ding, ding, oh. ding, 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 ding.
Yeah, that was my favourite.
Yeah.
Ding, 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 ding.
Yeah.
You're a fucking idiot. You know, I love it. I love it. And I think they took the piss a bit, but they were really artistic as well.
Yeah.
Couldn't I tell you what Peekaboo's about? Do we have any information about that?
Not really.
Peekaboo.
I only know a bit of an anecdote, but we'll go creep. It's sort of about a chick, but it's got like
ooh.
Creeping up the back stairs, slinking into dark stalls, shapeless and slumped in bath chairs, furtive eyes peep out of holes. She has many guises. She'll do what you want to her. Playing dead and sweet submission, cracks the whip, deadpan on cue. That's a description of any of the chicks at Revolver, really.
Yeah, yeah, but you know what it is? It's a peep chick. What do you call those chicks at peep? Peep
like
chicks?
Peep show.
Peep show. Peep show chick.
Peep yeah. show chick. Yeah. What? Let's ask an expert.
Yeah. Maddie. He's not in the room.
But then we've got reeking like a pigsty, peeling back and gagging free, flaccid ego in your hand, chokes on tears, can you understand? It's
would that be the client?
Lyrically beautiful.
Because they're all pigs.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Possibly.
Yeah, I think it's the client.
Possibly. But look, the song itself in terms of the sort of musicianship, it was a sample played in reverse of like a horn section
yeah,
of a song.
Yeah, 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 beautiful.
Yeah, which really to me isn't this is why I say it isn't sort of Susie and the Banshees, but it sounds really cool. It sounds really fucking awesome.
They got very artistic with their brass instruments and their drums and all that sort of stuff eventually
yeah.
later on.
Yeah.
Sort of to keep up with The Cure almost. I don't know if it
– Yeah, The Cure was doing this
like,
kind of
you
shit
You know what I mean?
Too.
And
yeah.
I think – they tried to really keep up with that kind of maybe they wanted some commercial success. I mean, you got to pay your rent, don't you?
Yeah, yeah,
you know?
Totally.
But she's a beautiful woman. That's – look, if you think you know what these songs mean, guys, put it on Spotify.
Yeah.
Someone gave us a message on Spotify and made it private. I can't open it, guys. It was about the last show and I'm trying to open it and it won't allow me to open it because it's not – it's private, not public. So
yeah.
I can't – and I really want to know what you wrote. So can you make it unprivate and make sure you don't make it private? You know what I mean?
Now, a bit of controversy because some of the lines of the song are, golly jeepers, where'd you get those peeper, where'd you get those weepers, peep show, creep show, where'd you get those eyes?
Peep show, there you go.
Which are from an old song, yes. 1938, called Jeepers Creepers. They very quickly, before there was any legal action, put the writers of that song on the co-songwriting credits.
Yeah. Yeah, they would have had to.
Which is what you should do.
So is there such a thing in the sex world of a wall where you can place your vagina in a hole and get it eaten out?
What's the address?
No, I'm thinking it's a
in
thing.
In Melbourne?
No. But
in
it needs
what,
to
in
be
like
a thing.
Amsterdam? Amsterdam have got everything.
Do you reckon?
Yeah.
I just often think that would be an easy thing because you could have five chicks lined up and then just you wouldn't see the uglies and then you'd get a head job. Be kind of cool.
I've thought about.
Should we open up
our No, I've seriously thought about opening up a suckatorium.
A suckatorium.
And it's just a shipping container, like a pop-up suckatorium.
Amazing.
You can have it down at St Kilda.
The 80s montage suckatorium.
Yeah.
I love it.
You go in there, people that want to get sucked off, they're on one side. People that want to suck somebody off, they're on the other side. Everyone wins.
That's right.
There's a fee to get in.
That's it. And the other thing is,
we're going to be shown something.
When you see 80s videos, a lot of hands would come out of holes in the wall.
Yeah.
And it was quite sexual, so why not stick a dick in a hole and...
Can I tell you something?
Pay money to suck it. You don't know. It could be a fat cunt. It doesn't matter. Right?
What, still the thin. Worst thing ever?
Yeah. Like, you know, a smelly bloody... You know what I mean?
Could be a fat cunt. Like the worst thing ever. Anyway, what was I going to say? Something about suckatorium. It's
suckatorium.
Such a good idea, I think.
Suckatorium?
A pop-up suckatorium. You have really good music
yeah,
in there.
Yeah, you have great 80s music.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You don't like, I don't know. You don't like
there's
sort of
gotta
have
be
dodgy
something
stuff.
Better than just talking and going, yeah, how are you, you know?
Yeah.
There's
exactly
gotta be
right.
Just an in and out thing.
If we're going to do sort of like stuff online like Tinder, let's cut to the chase. Let's have
a couple
the same,
of holes in a wall.
Cut out the
exactly.
middleman.
Fuck yeah. You could charge a fortune.
I fucking found my thought.
Yeah.
Years ago, there's a Melbourne theatre, a Melbourne dance company called Chunky Move.
Yeah, I know Chunky Move.
Yeah. So I went and did a show with them.
Did you?
Yeah.
But
yeah.
You're not chunky.
No, but I could move. Oh. Anyway. All we had to do.
Were they chunky or was it just because they were big?
No.
They were quite well.
Nothing about fat size. Yeah, so it had nothing to do with that. Anyway, what you had to do, because dancing is about making meaning with your body, yeah?
Yeah.
Through movement. Yeah. So what they were doing was sort of like bending the boundaries of that, yeah, what that actually meant. So that what they did is got these people who were willing to do it and they paid you to go into these massive big boxes in this beautiful gallery.
Right.
You go into these massive big boxes and get in there and get naked and like tuck your clothes down the end. And then there's all these holes you can't see in and people could just put their hands in there and feel the bodies. And so it creates meaning for the person that's like feeling, you know what I mean? And you're using
fucking
the body.
Hell.
Yeah.
That's sort of what I mean.
And so people were touching me and everything. And like some people are like recoiling and some people are like having a good old feel and everything.
Yeah.
One of my mates got wanked off by someone.
Wow.
And because this guy was a real pervert. He would fucking, if anybody showed
root the
this
ass
guy,
of a festive snake.
Yeah, it would not matter.
Yeah.
And he would have been all barred up just at the fact of being
naked.
Oh,
well, that's the thing. It doesn't even have to go that far because it's quite, wow, I'm in this room, I don't know what's going to happen.
So the person putting their hand in would have been feeling around, felt like a cock and like just gone for it.
Well, that's how Welcome to the Jungle should be run, that new TV show.
Welcome to the jungle.
No, what's it called? The jungle or whatever it is.
I'm a celebrity.
I'm
get
a celebrity.
Me out of here.
Get me out of here, right? Welcome to the jungle. Instead of putting their hands in crabs, they should put their hands in crabs.
Yeah, they yeah, they should. Exactly.
Well, there you go. That's where that tangent went. But look, yeah. Peekaboo, I reckon it's about a sex worker.
I reckon you're onto something.
Yeah.
And one is that, as you say, one is the sort of the worker and one is the client.
That's right.
Very good.
It's probably about religion. Mm-hmm. Who fucking knows?
Who would know?
The next song we're going to do is this one, which is one of mine. Now, this is a song we're going to mention by a band called Till Tuesday, which comes up in the music trivia segment. It's called Love in a Vacuum. Love in a Vacuum Till Tuesday.
God, I love her voice.
Fucking so do I.
How
she
awesome.
Rocks my world.
Yeah.
As a kid, I didn't know what Love in a Vacuum was.
You thought it was in a vacuum cleaner.
I did.
Yeah.
I thought, what vacuum can I use in the house to get some love? Right?
Did you do some experimentation?
Possibly. Who knows? But I just thought it was a bizarre song, but it's so good.
Yeah.
Love in a Vacuum. That's off the Till Tuesday record. And I had it on vinyl. Couldn't tell you what Love in a Vacuum was.
There was a time you opened up every doorway. You didn't mind if everything wasn't your way. Don't pull away. That goes against what you told me. I look in your eyes. I realize what you've sold me.
Oh, Love in a Vacuum. What is? Oh, okay. So is he a vacuum? You know when people used to come to your doors and sell vacuums? Is that what they're trying to say?
No, I think it's a vacuum meaning like it's just an area where there's like no air, you know, like there's sort of no atmosphere.
All crap.
Yeah.
Nothing. There you go.
There's nothing.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Because the video, I mean, she's a good songwriter. Amy
yeah.
really, really great. But I just wanted to bring that one up because I was just a little bit confused as a kid to what Love in a Vacuum was. I didn't find a vacuum passionate at all. And vacuums were a big part of the 80s.
They really were.
Use those little things that cats lie on and does the floor for yourself.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean?
The auto-vax, yeah.
Auto-vax. No one vacuums anymore.
No.
Well, maybe they do, but.
People buy their flooring now in their right. house based on whether or not you can have an auto-vac or not.
Oh, yeah.
So they
right.
don't get like weird scratches. Edging on anything.
Yeah. yeah
because your auto vac won't work.
Unbelievable. Well, there you go. That's that one. If you know the meaning.
There's our show.
No, it's not our show. We've got heaps more to go. This one is one of mine as well. Anyway, let's have a listen.
Yes, I felt the pull when the point of no return. Who can't you see? I'm here wrapped up inside your melody. Whoa, whoa. Let's back up the band and take all that Latin sound. Let those horns begin to flow.
Say, don't be such a nasty boy. You want to squeeze me tight and call me honey.
Wow, have you heard that?
Never in my life.
Right, Taxi Mary.
Right.
Joe Camilleri and Jane Clifton.
Oh.
The girl in the mirror is the same as a girl on the wall.
Never in my life
okay.
heard that.
The thing about Taxi Mary is it does not mention a fucking taxi once. And as a kid, I'm waiting for it, like, okay, where's the taxi? Come on, Taxi Mary. So it used to confuse me, but I absolutely love this song. I love Jane Clifton. Jane Clifton used to be in Prisoner.
So JoJo Zapp and the Falcons.
That's right.
And she does the film.
She does the,
right.
Don't be such a nasty boy. You want to squeeze me tight and call me honey?
See, I by the time I came along, Jane Clifton was sort of a certain age, you know what I mean? Like she wasn't, I wouldn't have never put her with JoJo Zapp and the
Falcons. Oh, no, this was a really obscure thing.
Oh, was it?
But Jane had her own song, Girl in the Mirror is the same as A Girl on the Wall, which
is
just as fucking camp.
Yeah.
But she was always in Prisoner. She played in Prisoner. She spoke like this, yeah.
Yeah,
you just go and shove it up your ass, you know. This is why I was on Wentworth. And Jane Clifton is also Sally Freud's sister, James Freud's
wife. Oh, yeah, of course.
So she had a band on Countdown called, oh, my God, if I know this, I'm going to be fucking very proud of myself. I think it was called Silhouette.
Okay.
Or Stiletto.
Stiletto.
I think it was something like that, her first band, and she was very androgynous.
Mm.
Very androgynous.
Yeah.
And I think it was Stiletto. And I love that name of that band as well. And then she did Taxi Mary, but there was no Taxi Mary in the song. And I really didn't understand what it was about. But I think the song's a ripper.
It really is. I'm trying to get some sort of lyrics.
Well, this is the thing. It's really kind of obscure. I did meet JoJo Zepp, well, I'll call him Joe Camilleri, the other night. I was talking to his guitarist, Claude, who I was in a band with in the 90s. And we were talking and Joe came up and said, oh, we need to go on stage. And he was lovely. And I fucking should have asked him about Taxi Mary. I just didn't think. But just a great song that I did not have a clue what it meant.
Yeah. I feel I'm walking on a tightrope with my heart as a shield, which is a good lyric.
Yeah.
Yes, I felt the pull when the bubble burst at the parking lot as I touched the point of no return. Can't you see I'm here wrapped up inside your melody? Very nice.
And that's what we're talking about with these lyrics. They sort of don't make sense. There's something else going on.
I wish I could write like that.
You can.
I wish I can write like
this. Anyone can.
You know what I mean?
You can. You'd be surprised. We'll write like this for Bats in Space.
Oh, yeah, totally. Yeah. I've done a project where I have written like this.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
I was just purely doing stream of consciousness.
Yeah.
As long as it vaguely rhymed.
Yeah.
as it was coming out.
Yep.
And I was like fighting my urge to go back and make it mean something. You know what I mean?
Mm.
Like fighting my urge to go through and edit and I'll change this to this so it makes more sense. You know what I mean? And I just, as long as it was evocative, I left it as it was.
Yeah, that's right.
What was that project called? I can't even remember.
But the thing is, it doesn't need to mean anything, which is amazing.
No.
But I like the songs like this where it's called Taxi Mary and there's no mention of a taxi whatsoever. I'm pretty sure there's not.
Yeah.
Mention of Mary or a taxi.
Mm.
So maybe Taxi Mary means she's a bit like a taxi, everyone's been inside her or something. I don't know. What the fuck's it mean? You know what I mean? And I fucking forgot to ask him.
Who knows?
You know? Mm. I was too worried about my own Taxi Mary. But anyway, let's go on to the next song. The next song is, oh, now, this is another one of mine because I've put yours at the end as well. I'm not a great fan of geography and right. This show you're going to find that out. Because the songs in this show have got to do with geography and mm-hmm. I had no idea what the fuck, what or politics, on? Right? Yep. Here we go. Track.
Fucking so sexy.
How sexy is it?
Just a beautiful
song. It's
so
fucking sexy. And when I heard this as a kid, I just went, I don't know what this means.
Yeah.
But I'm into it.
Yeah, yeah.
You know?
Absolutely.
And this is very Bats in Space as well because Dallas and I, when we do Spin Me Around, can go, we can get very Human League-y in the backing vocals. Like that's what Maddie loves about our version of Spin Me because we're very – what is, how does it fucking go? Oh, fuck. I wish he was here. But, excuse me. And we just really fucking, can we be bothered with that? You know?
Yeah.
And it's very Human League.
Yes. Yeah.
And because she's, Dallas is already like that.
Yeah.
And I just mimic Dallas.
Yeah.
But, the Lebanon. So I didn't know what a Lebanon was.
Mm.
I thought it was a disease.
Yeah.
I thought it was like leprosy. I don't know.
Oh, yeah.
Right? I have no idea. So we've looked it up and Maddie has worked out that it is – you haven't? Oh, you haven't looked it up? Okay. Is it to do with Lebanon? Obviously it's it
to
is.
To do with the Lebanese Civil War.
Right.
Yeah, which is sort of went from the 70s right through the 80s and I think finished in early 90s. And this is why we have so many sort of Lebanese Australian citizens.
What, like the Spots?
The Spots.
The Spots.
They all went to the Spots. Something like a million people left Lebanon because of the Civil War to come to various parts of the world, but especially Australia.
Yeah.
But it was sort of like a similar thing with what's happening with Palestine where like the little person is getting picked on and the rest of the world's doing nothing.
Yeah.
And so these guys thought, Human League thought like, why is nobody commenting? And this is the thing, the great thing as well, it was like in the 80s, you did speak about sort of political, you know, you did speak about political issues. And
yeah,
as long as it was a great track, people didn't give a fuck.
That's right.
If it was a shit song, people would judge it, you know. But if it was an awesome song, people would fucking get all around it. It was about music, but you could talk about whatever you wanted. I don't think anybody would be brave enough these days to release a pop song about Palestine.
Yeah, well, that's right.
You know what I mean?
Maddie's passed me a thing. I don't even remember. That's the thing, right? But I remember being in geography class. I had this woman that would no longer be alive now. She was Egyptian and she would teach us geography because it was always a European teacher.
Yeah.
Nowadays, every schmuck can do geography.
Yeah.
She was Egyptian, so you knew she fucking knew shit, right?
Yeah.
Because she'd lived it.
She traveled.
So she was worldly, that's right. She was worldly.
Yeah.
But in the 80s, it was different for us to see an Egyptian woman and they'd be really stern, like, you're not everyone, put your pencil down.
Oh!
Yeah, like really stern. I just remember, and I remember her mentioning Lebanon. And then it all made sense from Human League.
Yeah.
It was the other way around. Musically, I was taught about it.
Yeah.
And then she went, okay, in Lebanon. And I went, oh.
How fucking awesome, though.
Yeah.
It was from Human League that you learned about Lebanon.
Fucking everything. Music, full stop.
Oh, yeah, 100%.
Everything.
100%. Music in the 80s was the internet of today because it was your portal to the outside world.
That's it. And we should do an episode about songs with countries and stuff.
Oh, that's a good one.
Maddie thought of that this afternoon. Because
Wilde one?
Oh, you've blown it.
What is it?
Cambodia. That's one of my other ones. See what I mean? I'm no good at geography. I didn't know what Cambodia was.
Cambodia.
Was it fucking a garbage bin? I don't know.
Africa. Huh?
Focaccia?
Africa, yeah. Focaccia?
I don't know. I had no idea what it was.
Can you remember? Okay, so we played in Tassie the weekend.
Yeah, we did. You have a focaccia, did you?
No. So we did Launceston and then we did Launceston and then Hobart and on stage. Sammy, you remember this? You were like going, what size planes? Sammy was talking to the audience. She turned around to the band like went, what are those planes with the two wings like this? And somebody yelled out from the crowd, a biplane. And Sammy like went, oh, yeah, a fly plane. Oh, yeah, a fly plane. And like we're all looking at each other like, oh,
where's this going to go?
Fuck
yeah,
me.
Yeah, yeah.
A fly plane.
Fuck.
Not a biplane.
I don't know what he was talking about. Someone said a jet because we did Van Halen
Dreams.
Yeah,
that's right, that's
right. And I wanted to explain that the video clip had and Brad explained that the video had the Blue Angels or whatever that. And I went, yeah, and then they also have that, the two wing planes. And I went to Maddie, you know those ones.
What are those planes called?
And someone piped up and I still didn't get it.
Maddie like went, it's a jet. And the audience pissed themselves laughing.
Yeah, yeah.
Because
we just wanted to have a chat to the audience because it was a bit like a TV studio.
It was.
And it was incredible because you could walk up through the – it was like the Ray Martin show.
So we're talking about the theatre – the studio space of the Theatre Royal in Hobart, which was absolutely beautiful.
Mm.
And it was like Countdown.
It was. And I said to the guy, Ship of Fools, I said, we need to get some cameras in here and make it like a TV show where they see themselves on the screen.
Yeah.
And he goes, oh, my mate's in TV and we could get that happening, no worries.
Great.
And I went, I bet you could.
Gee, Ship of Fools was all right, wasn't he?
Ship of Fools was interesting.
I'd go on a few cruises there. That's one of the seamen.
Dear me. Dear me.
You with me?
Yeah, he was a young little monkey, wasn't he?
He was all right.
He wasn't young.
He'd been working there for 13 years.
So he'd be in his 40s. Maybe he's not.
But let's say he was 18 when he went and did work experience there.
Okay, so what is he now?
In his early 30s.
Oh.
In his early 30s.
Yeah. Nice guy. Here we go, next one. So, yeah, we've worked out that I'm shit at geography.
And I'm shit at maths.
Next
one. Right. Next
one, honey, is one of yours, I think. Yeah, oh, this is a good one. Here we go.
Uh-huh, uh-huh, uh-huh. Was ist los mit dir, mein Schatz? Aha. Geht es immer nur bergab? Aha. Geht nur das, was du verstehst? Aha. This is what you got to know. Love you though it didn't show.
Ich lieb dich nicht, du liebst mich nicht. Ich lieb dich nicht, du liebst mich nicht. Ich lieb dich nicht, du liebst mich nicht. Ich lieb dich nicht, du liebst mich nicht.
Da, da, da. Da, da, da. Da, da, da.
That was the original German version there.
Oh,
trio.
Did I play the wrong version?
No, no, no. That's the original version, right, which I wanted to play because it's very
trio.
Sort of...
that's right.
Very... what's that other German band? Luftballons. No, no, Luftballons.
Oh, right, Nina.
Yeah. But he's saying, da, 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 ich lieb dich nicht, du lieb mich nicht, which means I don't love you, you don't love me.
Oh.
So in the English version, yeah, I don't love you, you don't love me.
Wow.
Da, da, da. There was a French version as well.
Wow.
Very, very popular song this was.
It was.
Very popular song.
What's it about, a love song?
Who would fucking know?
Yeah, right.
Who would fucking know?
Good musically, like very typewriter-ish, like
it's just, you know, simple. It's just simple.
But the simple songs are the ones that are hardest to write because they've had the balls to just put down three instruments and be dickheads.
Well, it's just
it's
like,
a bit
like
craftworkish, a little bit.
With like a bass beat, you know what I mean? That's all it is.
Yeah.
And with like a cool vocal. He's got a good voice, you know. The English translated version, which, you know, maybe something's lost in translation, but it's just basically, what's wrong with you, my darling? Is it always just downhill? Is only what you understand possible? This is what you got to know. Loved you though it didn't show. I do not love you, you do not love me. It's as simple as that.
Right.
It's just
they've spit the dummy.
Just cracked it.
Yeah. Well, people loved it.
Yeah.
It's simple stupid, that's why.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know,
a da, 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 da.
Yeah.
It's just an easy listen.
It is an easy listen.
Very catchy.
Very catchy. And I think it charted in Australia, to be honest
with you. God, yeah. It was huge.
I think it was really, really big.
Yeah.
But I can't remember much about it.
Went to number four in Australia.
Wow. Aussies love Da Da Da.
Yeah.
Very, very.
I remember my brother saying, went to number one in New Zealand.
Of course it did.
You know, Switzerland, of course, like Austria and countries like that, number one. I remember so very clearly my brother singing it when I was a little kid. Da, da, da.
Yeah.
It was catchy.
Yeah, but that's the thing. It's still art, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's amazing. Good tune. The next one is a commercial. Here we go.
Shh. Bird watch. Shh. Oh, come a shot. I've been the beauties. So quiet.
We'll sing it up, baby, now.
Sing it up, baby.
Scratch and
sing. Right. The future of this company's on the line. I want all the figures. Jensen?
Yes, Sir Robert. I have here the complete fiscal records for the last five financial years and the figures year to date. These are all major related subsidiary companies for the investments.
Yourself an instant scratch it.
Scratch and shout.
I used to love that ad. Is that from the 80s?
Yeah. Well, this is when they first came out,
yeah,
I think.
Yeah, they did. It was huge, I reckon.
So the scenario with this commercial is they're bird watching and she does a scratchy.
As they're waiting.
And then she wins something and she can't, say
right.
anything because they're bird watching
and
doing
scream.
Something. That's right. And then the next scenario is
then
where
he breaks up with her. I don't know.
Yeah, no, they scream and they become rich. It was a really good promotional thing for when the Scratchies.
Because they were
maybe
cheap.
I'm wrong.
Because they were cheap. You could get them for like they
and they were and not
you
only
get them
cheap,
for 50 cents.
Not only cheap, they were right then and now.
Oh yeah.
With Tats Lotto, you needed to wait a week.
Yeah, that's right. And you could like put them in a gift card somebody's birthday.
Yeah.
Which was like a hugely popular thing.
It was
in Australia. You put like the scratchy in there.
Yeah. So, and then the next scenario is they're in a board meeting and he scratches it. The actor you would know in it actually, but there was a couple of scenarios. There was a nurse in a nursery.
They were huge,
babies.
These ads.
Yeah, big ads.
Very big,
ads.
Big campaign.
And
they're very popular.
Late
and
80s.
That's a cultural thing that really we don't do that often.
Series
I mean,
of them, yeah.
When I get scratchies for my birthday, it's from sort of elderly aunts
yeah, your
and
grandma.
Uncles and stuff,
yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And it came in the 80s, yeah. Very good.
Scratch
like
and shout.
Scratch and shout.
And it would have cost them a fortune to get that song as
God
well because it's
it was the
Beatles.
Yeah.
You know, Beatles would have gone, all right, we'll give it to you then.
And it was in Ferris Bueller as well.
Oh, yeah, right, of course it was.
It's all
out
coming
on that
together.
Street.
Wow, good song though.
Good memories to hear old commercials like that, you know?
Yeah.
But that's what we're all about in the 80s.
I remember him saying, I want all the fiscal figures. And me thinking, what are fiscal figures?
Physical figures?
Fiscal.
Fiscal.
Fiscal figures.
From really?
From the last fiscal year or something, he says.
Oh.
And I'm thinking, what does that mean?
Fiscal?
We were coming back from Launceston the other day on the plane last night.
Oh, yeah, right, okay.
And a little boy, little boy's been reading the entire trip, you know, right in front of us. Leo slept the entire way on my lap.
Great.
And the little boy says to his dad, Dad, what is minimum wage? And I said, I said to the dad, if he wants an example, he can look at my bank account.
Ah, yeah, right.
But yeah, just so funny. Dad,
God, how old was the kid?
What's minimum wage? He was in like primary school. But I shouldn't have butted in. I wanted to hear how the dad answered.
Mm. He'll find out, I'm sure.
Yeah, he'll find
out. Won't be long.
He'll find out.
Minimum wage.
But it's a good thing that we have a minimum wage in Australia. In some countries they don't.
No, that's right. Here we go. So that was the commercial. Hope you enjoyed that.
Scratch and
this
shout.
Song's a ripper. We were singing this on the weekend, Dallas and I, in our little band room. Here we go.
There we go. Everyone knows Talking Heads from that song.
That's right.
Do you think that's like the Talking Heads song? Do you think this is like kind of
– Road to Nowhere maybe?
Oh, yeah. See, even that, even Road to Nowhere is just like
– Oh, it's very negative, isn't it?
It's like, what the fuck are we talking
about? Yeah, no, but you know what? It was alarming. And it used to make me a bit scared listening to these lyrics because it was like, oh, my God, this guy's fucking got a point.
Yeah.
Where is my beautiful wife?
Yeah.
She's managing your band, motherfucker. you know what I mean? Like, it's just fucking really scary.
Yeah.
Because I was only young. Mm. What year did this come out? 83 or 4 or something?
Something like that. 81.
81. Fuck. Okay. So I'm 11 and he's basically telling you that all this shit's going to happen in your life.
Yeah.
And I don't know what it means because I haven't experienced this stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
But I was also alarmed by it because the music's quite alarming. Doom, doom, doom. Like it's like a hypnotizing piece of music.
So by Brian Eno.
Right, okay.
Yeah.
That makes sense. Because if you're being hypnotized by it's actually a brilliant piece of art. If you're being hypnotized by doom, 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 and then
yeah.
The lyrics mean more because you're in a pattern.
Yeah, listening. That's right. You're on the right track.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's what scared the fuck out of me because I picked up on that and I couldn't stop listening. And the more I listened to it, the more I got scared about getting into adulthood.
Yeah. Do you know what? The structure of it and everything, it's based on religious sermons.
Oh, right.
Where they would ask questions of the congregation and everything. So
which
everything
I knew
you've just
about.
Said, but everything you've just said feeds into that. The fear, you know, the fear, like the getting stuck in the loop kind of
that's
feeling.
Right.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. And it's incredible because that's how I felt as a kid where I hadn't had the experience of being married. I hadn't brought a dog and Dallas and I were singing it the other night. You may find yourself in a house with no fucking head, you know.
I do it too. You may ask yourself, where are my car keys?
You may ask yourself, why the fuck are you hanging out with this cunt? Like it's sort of that vibe.
Yeah, it
and
is.
It's an incredible piece of art because no one was questioning this shit.
No.
We were all getting married. Opening the legs, having a baby, paying for the baby, whatever we could get.
Yeah.
But what happens if the marriage breaks down?
And is that what he says at the end? He's like, what does it all mean?
I don't know.
Yeah, I think he says something like that.
It was just really full on as a kid to hear that.
I think it's just questioning the status quo, you know. Like
that's right.
Yeah.
And then they put out Burning Down the House and I'm like, oh, fuck, now I've got to think about the house burning
the house, the lyrics, you're like, what the fuck are you talking
about? Yeah, that's right. It was like a fucking really weird affirmation that you were going to meet when you were older.
Yeah.
And I was – and I think that's what – and this is why the Talking Heads band is so incredible because they were ahead of the time with how people thought. 81's an early year to be talking about this stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
Where life isn't perfect.
Yeah.
You know?
Mm.
And life isn't perfect. I don't care who the fuck walks around with their partner and holds hands and they're lovey-dovey. There is always shit going on backstage,
gotcha.
Mate. Absolutely.
100%.
You know?
100%.
I'd rather see a couple be normal and not like a fairy tale.
Yeah.
Because I know there's something substantial there.
Yeah.
And this was the thing with these songs, but I couldn't tell you what the song's about. All it's about fear for me.
I don't think anybody could tell you what it's about. But it's certainly – it's raising questions. It's getting you to – I guess it's getting you to ask yourself, you know, like all of these. So I'll go through. You may find yourself living in a shotgun shack.
Wow.
You may find yourself in another part of the world.
Wow.
You may find yourself behind the wheel of a large automobile. You may find yourself in a beautiful house with a beautiful wife. And you may ask yourself, well, how did I get here? So I guess it's sort of saying any random situation, you know, you may ask yourself, how did I get here? But some people don't.
They fucking don't. 100% they don't.
Yeah.
And this is what it's about, I think.
And then letting the days go by, let the water hold me down. Letting the days go by. Water flowing underground into the blue again after the money's gone. Once in a lifetime, water flowing underground. I love all the letting the days go by though. It's just like those kind of people that like time passes day after day and they just – they're not questioning the world and their place in the world and you know what I mean?
Relationships with people.
Yeah, yeah. Life just happens to them.
And I think the water underground is all the emotions, like water's all based on emotional
– yeah.
Piscean energy, I'm assuming, but really fucking powerful. Oh,
I love it. I love Talking Heads.
Yeah.
Yeah, love these guys. You know, the film clip was directed by Toni Basil as well.
What?
Mm. So she sort of
Basil.
She did some of the choreography. So you know he's doing that like that
yeah,
step.
Yeah, it's interesting.
That famous step. Yeah.
Do you know there's another song we're gonna play at the end of this show where Paula Abdul choreographs the video as well. And in the 80s, even to get choreography where you are marching,
yeah,
you needed a choreographer.
Yeah, absolutely.
It was something that you paid for because some of these performers needed a bit of help.
But you just get an expert, you know.
That's it.
Rather than put yourself out there like a dig.
Well, that's right. But, I mean, David Byrne always had great moves anyway.
He loved collaborating with people.
Yeah. Mm. Love it. Yeah, great tune, baby.
Awesome.
I love it. Now let's have a look at – oh, here's mine. Here we go, another geography case.
Oh.
Record Select by Kim Wilde.
Yeah.
Brought me up on so many questions and feelings and what is she talking about? It's so fantastic, you know. Cambodia.
So much depth in pop music.
Oh, didn't know what Cambodia was.
Incredible.
Was it a bird?
Mm.
Was it a snake?
Yeah.
Amazing track.
Yeah, beautiful.
Fucking really moving. It moves with you. The whole – if you don't have Select by Kim Wilde and you're a Kim Wilde fan, I don't even think you're a Kim Wilde fan if you hadn't. Select was one of her best records.
Yeah.
This was the tape I got when I was 13.
Yeah.
And I used to sit there with my jugs on, earphones.
Yeah.
For fucking hours and just dream of this music.
Yeah.
Go through different scenarios in my head. And the one song that used to fuck me up was Chaos at the Airport. And I've told Kim Wilde herself and she just pissed herself laughing. But this was years ago now. But Cambodia, the video clip was amazing. Mm. It had snakes and like fly bloody screens and stuff. And she looked incredible.
Yeah.
And he was a pilot, which scared the fuck out of me as well.
Well, he was Thailand-based. She was an Air Force wife. He used to fly weekends. It was the easy life. But then it turned around and he began to change. She didn't wonder then. She didn't think it strange. But then he got a call and he had to leave that night. He couldn't say too much, but it would be all right. He didn't need to pack. They'd meet the next night. He had a job to do, flying to Cambodia. Flying to Cambodia. And it was so like fearful, like it put so much sort of fear in you, like as a little kid, like what the fuck does this mean?
I thought you know what it meant for me? I thought if you met someone when you were older or whatever, 18, and this guy was just going to leave to Cambodia.
Yeah.
Do they all leave to go to Cambodia? I wasn't sure.
Yeah. Is that where people like go to hide?
It's like the Bermuda Triangle. Right? I don't know. I just thought, oh, Kimmy, I'm so sorry.
Yeah.
Because I took every one of these lyrics literally.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And if you listen to Select, you do because you've got – the next song we'll be doing in Rewind Addies is View from a Bridge, everyone, so get fucking excited. Great.
Awesome.
I guess it all began about a year ago, right? Fucking View from a Bridge is the greatest dance track because it's dum 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 dum. You know,
yeah,
it's
amazing. Yeah, yeah.
So I want to do that and I want to do tracks that other bands wouldn't think about.
Nah, that's it.
And especially for the Commercial Hotel on the 4th of May.
Yeah.
Because we're going more electro –
yeah.
Synth.
Yeah.
And View from a Bridge is very synthy.
Yeah.
Maddie will go, no, I don't want to do it, but fuck it, we're doing it. It was the 80s. View from a Bridge in Cambodia and this album was the 80s.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
The other stuff like Set Me Free, Why Don't You? But like that was great, but it wasn't her early stuff.
Nah, nah.
Like Checkered Love and.
Yeah.
Like this is where Kim really shines. But yeah. The stories were scary.
Yeah, they were. So much depth to them.
What happens if I go out with a pilot? Am I going to be hanging around a fucking
– So you're going to go to Cambodia?
Yeah, with a snake and a fucking little bed that hangs off the trees. What are they
– Hammock.
Hammock. Fucking get – I was going out to buy a hammock that afternoon. I didn't know what the fuck. I was like, is this is what's going to happen to me? I know it's going to happen to me, you know. Not too far from the truth. But, yeah, I loved it. I loved it. But yeah. I didn't know what Cambodia was. I did not have a clue. Again, astrology – sorry, not astrology. Geography teacher, never brought up Cambodia, but I think I might have asked her, what's Cambodia?
At a similar time, there was big unrest in Cambodia as well.
Yeah.
So it was like – we were hearing these names of countries that we never knew a thing about.
Yeah, that's
on
right.
On the news, and it was always like, oh, what the fuck's going on, you know? So there was that sort of like fear factor attached.
Absolutely.
You know?
You just didn't know. All right, we better keep whizzing through. Now we've got Lily on the line. We're going to do some music trivia now.
Before we go, we're going to do a bit of trivia.
Oh, my God.
Our good friend Lily.
Here we go. So, JB, we've got some trivia.
How exciting.
Oh, my God. And who's on the line tonight?
Someone very special. What a surprise.
Really?
Yeah.
Give me a clue.
She's hot.
Hot. Good. Where does she –
She's got glittering eyes.
Glittering eyes.
Yeah.
And it's Lily.
Eyes.
Oh, my God. Lily, how are you?
Good, guys.
We got you on for some trivia. How's your life?
Life is good. We're out here in Lockport, little coastal town, up bush.
In your caravan?
No, well, the caravan's on Dad's place that I'm slowly doing up, but we're the other end, Paris end of Lockport.
Do you want to get a plug in for the caravan?
Not yet. Wait. For
not yet.
What's the caravan going to do if you give it a plug? Fucking sing and dance.
Well, I just want to be able to stay in it myself, but I would love to have it for family and friends when you guys come up and play.
Oh, yeah.
Maybe.
You should list it on
Palm Springs-esque kind of little
It's beautiful. So, you should list it on Ripper Ride. Have you heard of Ripper Ride?
I follow them. How good are they?
Yeah.
Ripper Ride?
Yeah, it's Ripper like Airbnb for holiday homes.
Wow.
We're a little bit more open here. Great.
I think Ripper the caravan Ride would do very well on Ripper Ride.
You're a Ripper Ride. I love you guys. And now my new friend Megan Boyd is sick.
I know, right?
We discuss every week. We're so excited.
Amazing. It's like got book, her club.
Wayne Chung
book club. Book club for fucking...
I haven't listened to that episode yet. Don't tell me anything.
Yeah.
Have you listened to songs that don't make sense? Because we're doing part B of that tonight.
Oh, no, that's the one she was talking about. I know Wayne Chung's coming up. I heard that on the previous episode.
Yes.
Through the Roof, which has been playing the whole album on Spotify. Yes. Which you guys also feature on. So, no, I'll listen to that tomorrow.
Amazing.
Yay.
All right. So we're going to give you some trivia. Jay's going to start with some questions. What would you like trivia about? An artist or whatever?
What about movies?
I'm here with Lyndon.
Hi,
lovely Lyndon.
Hi, Lyndon.
Hi. How are you both?
Hey, Lyndon.
Very well.
He's a DJ.
I've been listening to
80s
music all day.
Forever.
What was the bangers you have been playing? What have you been playing?
Bit of Yazoo.
Oh, lovely. Don't go.
Alice Moore.
Dead or Alive.
Dead or Alive.
Good.
What about Glass Tiger?
Oh, wow. Don't you forget me when I'm gone. Don't forget.
I
love
it.
That song. It's a bloody good song.
I love it. Yeah,
Corey
Hart was.
Did you like Corey Hart?
Loved. And Nick Kershaw.
Yeah, right.
Everyone loved Rob Lowe.
Well, your vagina would come up to Nick Kershaw's head, so that wouldn't have worked. Right?
I don't mind that fact. No.
Yeah, well, that's true. I would have liked to watch that too.
No,
yeah,
anyway.
That's right. Everything you can eat. Or you can eat smorgasbord. It fucking.
Bring it back.
We need some undies of written on them.
Yes, that's right. All right, we've got some.
Subject matter. Yes. I'd say chicks of the 80s, so that's my thought.
Chicks 80s. Of the 80s. Oh, yes. There you go.
Yeah.
Here we go.
All right.
Chicks of the 80s. Just give me a moment.
Chicks of the 80s. So I'm going to ask you a question about a chick of the 80s.
Okay.
Who was the lead singer of Till Tuesday?
Oh, I know. Get me down now. Don't know her name though, but I love that song.
Thought you knew Chicks of the 80s.
I love her, but I would have said Till Tuesday. I wouldn't know her actual name. No Googling, Lyndon.
No Googling, it's not
80s. Come on, why can't I do it?
That's not 80s of you. I'd call my sister right now and be like, stand up.
Amy Mann.
I've heard you guys speak of her as well.
Yeah, Amy Mann. There you go. All right, that's one wrong.
I'm thinking Tracy Mann. Wasn't there a Tracy Mann?
Tracy Mann was the chick in Sweet and Sour that did Deborah Conway's voice.
Okay, I knew there was that show. Okay.
Very close, though.
Right.
Can I give you one that's kind of, well, I think it's a bit easy. Yeah. But it'll be good to have a little win, you know?
All right, yes.
She's always winning.
She's always winning.
I feel so ashamed if I don't get any.
It's about film. It's in the category of film. It is okay. Chicks of the 80s, but what was the name of the character played by Sigourney Weaver in the 1986 film Aliens?
I knew there's one. I don't watch horror movies except Rocky Horror Show.
Lyndon might know.
Lyndon?
Maybe.
I remember that. Get away from her, you bitch.
Hey,
look out. I remember the alien looking at her in the face.
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
I remember her in Ghostbusters, the Keymaster, or whatever.
Yeah, she should have brought out a song, actually, don't you think?
She should have with the cat.
Ellen Ripley.
Yeah. Oh, very good. It's Ellen Ripley. Very good. Right. Ding, 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 ding.
Come on,
Ellen Ripley.
Poor old Eileen.
Poor Eileen.
She copped it,
didn't
she?
Else has.
Anyway, we got it.
Yeah. You got it.
One and one.
Did we win? Chico Roll.
Yep, we could get organised that up where you are, actually, in Gippsland.
Love that story.
Okay.
Can I give you one another one in the category of film, if that's all right?
Yeah. Is it Michelle Pfeiffer as Stephanie Deneau?
No. No, it's not. But it is connected to Sigourney Weaver, who I do. But it's not her. Who starred as Tess McGill in the 1988 film Working Girl, earning her an Academy Award nomination?
It was what's
her name's mum. Her mum, John Johnson's wife.
Yes.
Ooh.
Fingo's mum. I don't know if that'll.
Jeez, we better start some trivia up in Gippsland.
I don't know if that'll qualify. Fingo's mum.
Thingo's mum.
Everyone's
He's
Thingo's mum.
Got it going on.
Look,
Thingo's mum.
He's on the cusp of the why and
the. I think. Yeah.
Really.
Maybe if I repeat the question, it'll just come to you like a flash. Who starred as Tess McGill in the 1988 film Working Girl, earning her an Academy Award nomination for Best Actress?
Melanie Griffith.
Holy shit. Good Google. Very good.
Very
so
good.
Funny. I saw like a meme recently and they redid them with modern hair.
Yeah, right.
I liked her better though with the orange hair.
And Joan Cusack was the friend, like coffee, tea, me, remember?
I love her.
She was all great.
Yeah, she is good.
Yeah, all the Cusack.
Good. Very good.
Oh, I love that.
Do we have a girly of the 80s question or was at all?
Yeah, they've all been girlies of the 80s.
Oh, no, like,
chicks of the 80s.
Oh, the movies? Okay, do you want movies or do you want music?
I like movies, good.
Okay, good. All right, sorry.
Like soundtracking movies, 80s. Yeah.
Right. Okay. Let's. I'll give you another one. Would you like? Okay. Here's one. Here's a movie one. You might like this.
All right.
Which American actress played the role of Claire Standish in the 1985 film The Breakfast Club?
Oh, Claire. That's a factor of name. Not that. But you will be.
It sure was. Very good. I knew you would give us that line as well. How did I know?
Montage. No, sorry. What is it called? The steel J. You're an actor, you know.
Flashbacks.
When you do a steel, like a monologue.
Monologue.
There we go. We got there.
All right, we better. So you're both together, so we've got another couple of questions.
Lyndon, you do this.
So, Lyndon, you were a DJ at the boutique or something? Was that right?
Yeah.
Fantastic. What was that night called again?
Flash. And it was all 1980s music. And it was
That's
great.
Right.
For about 10 years.
It was great.
Fashion.
Eric,
yep. Eric, yeah. Sorry. I auditioned Rewind 80s with that band. With that venue, I think. I think it was Rewind 80s. It might have been called something else. Might have been called something else.
I think Phil Sobrano came on and we did a little kind of live stuff, early before the night took over. But I think the attention span for them watching live music.
No, they wanted to snort coke and fucking rub each other up and down. That's right.
That sounds all right.
It was all fun, dance. And,
yeah, it was good. We'd roll
Oh, it worked because what's his name was at the door? Fucking Models Inc.
Oh,
that's an 80s question.
Alex wasn't it?
Nah, from Sale of the Century.
Fudge.
Yeah.
Target model, too.
Yeah.
Fudge is pretty
80s. Fudge had a really hot younger brother, Rob. I remember him, too.
Yeah, right. Now, Fudge still looks great now, but Fudge is very 80s.
It's so funny. Like, I just haven't been in that world for so long, so they pop up on Facebook or something.
Fudge was going to marry James Packer for a while. His name was going to be Fudge Packer.
Is that before or after?
That's so great. That's so great. Oh, we're like a party trick. You can't get away. I love it.
Go to the green room.
I know. Poor Fudge. Someone will fucking tell him.
Poor old Fudgy.
Yeah, I thought it was going to be a serious thing then, and I was like, oh, really? No. We got another question?
We do. I'm cooking it up. Trust me.
Cooking it up. Trust you.
Where are you guys tonight? Like, where? I know you're at Locksport, but where?
Because they've come down to Lockie from Melbourne. And we had a big lunch at the Locksport Marina Hotel where you guys will soon be playing.
Oh, yeah.
And then we're in a little B&B at the end of the street there. So we just had a big, fabulous dinner. Had an old friend pop in and cook us a nice carbonara.
Wow. And,
garlic bread.
Yeah, old school 80s.
Oh, yum.
It was good. So we've drank our drink dry, so yeah. I might have to move on to the red and then pause the clock to 2 o'clock.
Yeah, right.
Sing my wine. No.
Love
it. It's been fun. It's been really nice.
And I lost the pool.
Oh, yeah, we play pool next door.
Oh, yeah.
The bar flies.
Wow.
You won.
Oh, yeah. No, I didn't. I was the worst. Anyway, we're now going off on a tangent.
Yeah, we are.
That's all right.
Yeah.
That's what we do here.
That's what we do.
Got another question.
It's an exciting world.
The female front woman of the band Eurythmics, what was her real name?
Shut up from the peanut gallery over there.
Oh, we've got an
Annie
audience.
Annie
Lennox. We've got an audience.
Well,
that
would be.
No, but he said real name.
Well, wouldn't it be Anne?
What's her pretend? Her like that.
Follow your instinct, Lele.
Annie would be Anne, wouldn't it?
Your instinct. Is that your final answer?
Annie Lennox. Lock it in, Eddie.
No, Anne Lennox.
Very good. It's Anne Lennox.
Anne Lennox. Wow.
You should always follow your instinct. Very
wow.
good.
I love it. You were like, what's his name on How to Win a Millionaire, whatever, that tells them when they've got it right. They go, keep going.
Yeah, that's it. You're on the right track. Yeah.
We could do how do you want to be a millionaire and fucking this way or this way.
Yeah, what's that? Eddie McGuire, because when we did puppets back in the Odeon or whatever, when we did the Pal, what's it called? The Palo, what's the one in the Crown Casino?
The Odeon.
Or whatever. No, but we'd be getting changed and that Eddie McGuire would come in, like, sniffing around and have a chat.
Oh, that's right.
Would it really?
One-eyed serving.
Fucking one-eyed Colin would support on my ass. One-eyed penis, look.
Hey, fucking. Oh! We're doing all right.
The only eye he was using was in his penis. Looking for Lele in her dress.
He knew what was good.
The old man.
Maybe he was sniffing out
the old
fucking.
Man.
Doesn't matter.
You're the old man, Jason.
That's it. I am. Getting closer and closer to the old man, I tell you what.
I know.
All right. Hang on. Give me all three names, first name and last name of every member of Bananarama.
Wow. Oh, my God. The fucking psychic. It was it.
Because he was in Bananarama. I knew it was coming. All right.
Devon. Wait, the surname. I know the
Karen. There was Karen, Devon, and.
Devon, Karen, and Sarah.
That's right.
Sarah. Yes.
Surnames.
So we've got. Can I do this, please? I'll give all the names of the three because I love Bananarama. And I love Stock Aitken and Waterman.
Oh, yes.
Karen Woodward.
Yes.
Devon Faye.
Yep.
Sarah Dallin.
Dad, you didn't know that.
Very good.
I know. I love them.
That's a winner.
Ding, 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 ding.
Did you see Matt Day and Byron do Bananarama?
Yes.
They were
out. Bananarama. Yeah.
Bananarama. That was great.
Chill out. Years ago, that was the very last gig we did before lockdown.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh
my God. Was too.
It was a good festival. I did Chill Out Festival too. That was great to work for. That was a fun gig.
But wait, can we do an extension on this answer? Oh, remember God. This is how much I love Bananarama. Karen was pregnant. No, Karen,
your time starts
Karen
now.
Was pregnant in Loving the First Degree in the film clip, or was it Siobhan?
No, because Siobhan had a baby with fucking the Eurythmics dude. Karen fucked one of the dancers, so I think it was Karen that was pregnant, yeah.
They know their shit, these guys. This is why
And the fill-in went to their high school, Jackie Mullins, or something. What was her name? Remember?
No one knows.
No one knows.
Anyway.
Jackie someone. But it's been amazing having you on.
Yeah, thanks, guys. Good on you.
Oh, we're going to have to get you to the band room eventually, though.
We are. We've got something.
I'm already in the band room every time I listen to you guys. It's just so familiar.
We've got something planned for you. We've got a really good subject that we think you'd know everything about coming up soon.
The fluff.
No. Female 80s movies.
Best sluts of the 80s.
No.
It's not actually. It's a really good
biggest
one.
Sluts of Melbourne from the 80s.
Sammy,
I'll be in that list. Sammy
no,
is in that.
I'm not ashamed.
No.
Nor should you
no,
be.
No, you should not be. God.
I love
absolutely.
You guys. Thank you, though.
Love you too. Hey. Thanks, baby. What enjoy your night.
All right. We hope to speak to you again, sweetie.
Definitely. Love to Maddie as well.
All right, then.
We'll see you soon.
Love you guys.
Bye, guys.
Bye, darling.
Thank you.
Bye, babe. Bye. Love you. Bye.
We built this city. We built this city on rock and roll. We built this city. We built this city on rock and roll.
Fuck, John Farnham dodged a bullet, didn't he?
He did. He turned this one down,
oh,
didn't
good.
He? Your
I fucking hate it.
Your old friend Grace Slick.
Yeah, Grace Slick.
Isn't it funny? You would have never thought, you know, you look at sort of Jefferson Airplane back in the day and then over time becoming Starship.
Yeah.
You would have never, ever thought they would have become that. What they'd
become. Oh, no, fuck no. No. But we couldn't, when you look back to it, because I didn't know who Jefferson, I didn't know who they were. I only knew after the fact.
Yeah.
She just looked like she'd been shot and poisoned. Like it just, I just didn't like the look on her face, you know? Just fucking shotgun.
She did a bad acid trip at. What's it called?
So what did you get confused about? I haven't sent this.
Knee
deep in the hoopla.
The every lyric in the song.
Shocking.
Say you don't know me or recognize my face. Say you don't care who goes to that kind of place. Knee deep in the hoopla, sinking in your fight. Too many runaways eating up the night. And there's no clarity. It's sort of someone's always playing corporation games. Who cares? They're always changing corporation names. It's so strange. They're bringing up like corporation names and corporation games and shit. But where they had come from was like the 60s and Woodstock and all of that. And here they are like delivering this like really homogenized commercial rock. You know what I mean?
That's right.
So yeah. I think this is like why this is one of the most hated songs of the 80s.
Is it?
It is. It really is.
Thank God.
No, it's not just us.
Well, we've done it in The Puppets.
But I always
think
there's something catchy about it.
Yeah, see, it's dumb shit.
I hate I hate Wake Me Up as well. But I can see the value in doing Wake Me Up.
I prefer Wake Me Up than this though.
Oh yeah. Gotcha.
You know, Wake Me Up at least has some substance.
Yeah.
This is just fucking.
But I think to myself, okay, I hate Wake Me Up. I've got, you know, I've got a bias there. I also hate this.
Yeah.
But Wake Me Up works. Would this work? Like if
it did work when we did it with the puppets.
They used to fucking love it.
And I'm pretty sure Maddie said we should do it. I think it was Maddie's idea to put
it
in.
We've done
it
as a trio, haven't we?
Oh, it's fucking horrible. The lyrics are fucked.
Mm.
I don't know if they're trying to say that musos are getting ripped off with corporations and bars and clubs or whatever. But I am not surprised when you watch the John Farnham doco, you hear them going, "We rejected, we built this city." John Farnham. For me, the hero is John Farnham in this story.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because John Farnham knew fucking music. Because when you hear Whispering Jack, that would not have worked on Whispering Jack.
No.
Horrible.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yet someone comes close. Everything else on Whispering, like Someone Comes Close is my favourite. Mm. It's just so sexy, which I think is Eric McCusker.
Mm.
Sorry, Eric. I know it's Eric McCusker. 100% Eric McCusker. And I just think there were so many great tracks that for them to reject this is legendary.
Yeah. Yeah.
I reckon when we did it in the puppets, it was divine timing for that cunt. It actually worked because no one had thought about it.
Yeah.
I don't think – no one sort of comes up to us and goes, will you do – we built this city, yet Wake Me Up, they will.
Yeah, that's true. No one will ever come up and tell you to do this song. But it will still work.
Of course it will.
Like it will still work.
It's just damaged goods. I just can't do it. And I don't understand it.
You know what? I'd rather do View from a – you know, I'd rather –
View from a Bridge.
You know what
yeah,
I mean?
That's right.
It wasn't I'd the rather 80s. Take a risk.
It wasn't even – look, it might have gone number one in the 80s.
Yeah.
But I don't know who was buying it.
Just – well, it was radio fodder.
Yeah,
it was
well, that's
just,
right. Yeah, the radio was playing.
Commercial radio fodder.
Yeah.
You know?
And they were Jefferson Aeroplane. Everyone loved that shit, whatever. But she was as scary as your fucking auntie, huh? Auntie fucking
you
Vera.
You fucking love her.
I don't like her.
You love her, Sammy.
I would rather watch the other crazy that sings Venus.
How many people do we know looks like her though?
Every second person. It's some. There is something that goes
on. Hey, we
on.
Missed out on the old Mole Creek Festival this year, didn't we? Like a couple of people got up us about that, didn't they?
Yeah, but we're not with the agent anymore, so he's not going to book us.
Ah, yeah, of course.
So
can't we just like talk to them directly?
Of course we can.
Yeah.
But they're not going to do it because he's going to come back at me and go, well, I booked you for blah, blah, blah. The thing is.
We can do it next year.
We can do it whenever we want.
Yeah.
The thing is. That's what building rapport does, you know. And we actually did all right there. Like it was really good for us and stuff. Yeah. But
well, it was our inroad into Tassie.
Yeah, that's right.
You know.
But thank you for those ones that, why aren't you at Mole Creek, you mole?
Yeah, we had to come down here.
Yeah, we did.
Had to come
but
down
interesting,
to
Launceston. Wasn't it? I think she sort of had something to do with the Mole Creek committee as well. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
But look, at the end of the day, there's so many politics and stuff and that's fine. But we can go to Mole Creek. Yep. I don't give a shit.
Yeah.
You know?
It's good to be missed. We might
Yeah,
do
there
it
was
next
a lot
year.
Of people at the Launceston venue.
Yeah.
And they were so good. The crowd was so great.
Yeah. Yeah.
It was beautiful. Really beautiful. Looking at doing that again, but there's a couple of other venues that may want us too. So we're just checking out a few things. So there you go. That's our show. We built this city.
Yeah. Good on you guys. Nice song. What the fuck does it mean? Who knows?
Fucking I don't know.
Now, thank you. Please like, share, rate and review. give us 5 stars and write us a little note in the comments section. You know what to do. Become a subscriber. Hit subscribe on whatever platform you're listening to this show on.
And download the show. Now, you guys have been amazing. I think we've been in the top 100 for the last 4 weeks. Going in and out of the top 100, which is really special, and we really appreciate it.
Yeah.
Because other people get to see it.
That's it. And I mean, we've got sort of multiple episodes in like the top 200.
Yeah, we have.
Let's push them all up there. We have. You know what I mean? So like if you do make comments in the comment section on iTunes or Spotify, if you do give us a 5-star review and give the episode a review, this is what pushes 100%. It up the charts, guys. Mm. So thank you very much.
And I don't think people realise that you can help put it up in the charts.
Yeah, you know? Yeah. And our listeners that love us and listen to us week after week after week, you're really helping us by doing this.
You are. And our new Tasmanian people.
Yeah, we loved meeting you guys.
So good.
It was awesome meeting you in Launceston out the side of the venue.
Yeah, and the thing is with this podcast, you're going to hear when we're back again before anything, you know, that we give a little bit of a clue and we let you know different gigs. But the gig I want to look at is the South Morang Commercial Hotel, May the 4th would be with you.
Yep.
Come in a costume. There are going to be prizes. It's sort of like a Star Wars day, but we're going to go New Romantic and do some – we did Planet
Earth.
Are
you going in a costume?
Yeah. Dallas and I are going as Layla.
Layla?
Not what's her name?
Princess Leia.
Leia. Layla.
You're going to go as Layla.
Yeah, going to go as Layla. whatever her name is, just get a fucking couple of white sheets and do the hair. It's going to be an amazing night because it's going to be electro
80s. I dare you to do the hair, Semi.
Oh, that's easy because I've long hair.
I dare you to do the hair.
Really?
It will bring the fucking house down.
Well, Dallas wants to do it as well.
It'll bring the fucking house down.
So funny.
It'll be – I'm just going to come as a Wookiee.
Go as a Wookiee. Yeah. Well, it's Star Wars Day. We're not saying we're going to dress up as a Star Wars cast, but my biggest dream is to have a Star Wars band. But I don't think you'd get away with it because they'd be after you. Do you want to do the song?
You got to get the band learning that.
Well, the thing is, it's really hard to learn because it's really – tricky.
It's a good song.
It's a great song. Mm. There is a disco version of the do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do.
Oh, is it really?
Yeah. So we might do that. But, yeah, get your ticket for the commercial. It's pre-sale and it's already selling really fast. There's 150 tickets sold. So
beautiful.
Commercial Hotel, the 4th of May.
Everyone in Melbourne, see you there. Thank you, guys. If it's music, mateys.
Or cool shit from the 80s.
We're going to talk about
Unreal.